Tonight we're in the fifth chapter of the Gospel of John. This will be our 67th exposition of this epistle. We're going to be in verses 37 through 40 of the fifth chapter. Now Jesus taught men that what they thought about him identified them. And what they thought about him also determines their eternal destiny. God, and we're going to see in this text, does not give men the freedom to think about who he sends however they please, or however they see fit. God doesn't give man that kind of freedom. If people don't think of Jesus correctly, it isn't because they were free to make the wrong choice. It's because they were deluded. I mean, you gotta really see this, because there's been a lot of talk about man's freedom, and it's about 90% cheap baloney. It's not true. Moses didn't talk about anything like that. The prophets didn't talk about anything like that. John the Baptist didn't talk about anything like that. Jesus didn't talk about anything like that. And the apostles didn't talk about anything like that. They never did depict anybody as free that didn't choose Jesus. They never did. And we're going to see that very clearly in this text tonight. We can think of this not receiving someone God sends. About how God referred to the people who didn't receive the prophets. He sent prophets to them. They weren't well received, as you know. Here was what he said about it. Jeremiah 7:25. Since the day that your fathers came forth out of the land of Egypt unto this day, I have even sent unto you all my servants, the prophets, daily rising up early and sending them. Now, how is he going to regard their response to this? Every day, there was some prophet that had a word from God for the people. Here's what he said. They rejected the prophets. He said, yet, as Jeremiah 7:26, the verse following the one I just read, yet they hearkened not unto me, nor inclined their ear, but hardened their neck. They did worse than their fathers. Now, he said he sent prophets, but he said the people didn't hearken to him. You know what I'm saying? He didn't say they didn't hearken to the prophets. So they didn't hearken to him. But they hardened their neck and they got worse. The nation got worse. Now this is still true. Mm-hmm. People who are exposed to what God has said, particularly about Christ, who do not pay attention to it, this is logged down in heaven. It is noted. Mm-hmm. And those people will get worse. They will not improve. Gotta see to it they don't improve. See? Mm-hmm. The point I'm making here is that whenever God sends somebody to humanity, they had better listen to what that person says. Amen. Now, Moses was the first one of record that had a message to deliver to the people. Noah didn't have a message to, he was a preacher of righteousness. We get that was the 480 years before he got into the ark. But once he started building, the preaching stopped. Because God told him only eight. What would be the purpose of preaching repentance for Pete's sake? I don't know why people don't figure this out. He told him only eight people are going to be saved. Amen. Told him right up front. And the first hammer that struck the blow, if there was any preaching before that, it ended. That was it. They had to listen to what he had to say before that, not after it. Jesus said the same thing about the apostles who he was going to send into the world. He said, he that receives you receives me. How's that? And he that receives me receives him that sent me. See, here come the apostles. They proclaim Christ. Whoever rejects them has rejected them, Jesus, and God. How would you like to have that on your record? Are going to be people who have that on their record? Or are you aware of how many church people hardly know anything that the apostles said? You do your homework and see if you can find out how popular apostolic writings are, and you will find they are not popular at all. Few people have any idea what the epistles say. They've rejected them, which means they rejected Christ and they rejected God. That's serious business. He went on to say, all men should honor the Son even as they honor the Father. Well, Muslims don't do this. We know that. So much for worshiping the same God. Not so much for that. Whoever doesn't, they should honor the Son like they do the Father. They don't even acknowledge the Son. Okay. The point I'm making here is that God's serious about what he's, when a message comes from God, it's not sent so people can examine it and test it. We test what men say. We don't test what God says. We don't test what Jesus says or examine it or prove it. We have to prove what men say, not what Jesus or God says, nor the apostles. Although they could stand up to a test, but they're not to be viewed that way. Key men that God sent to the people Jesus was talking to include Moses, the prophets, John the Baptist, and later the apostles. If you wonder how serious God is about saving men, look how many messengers he sent to tell about salvation, to alert people to it. Now, since Jesus has ascended into heaven, exposure to the truth is increased exponentially. Even at this present time, with Jesus in heaven, he's still teaching. Paul said to the Ephesians, you have not so learned Christ, if so be that ye have heard him and been taught by him the truth as it is in Jesus. Well, Jesus had never gone to Ephesus. So far as we know, nobody from Ephesus traveled over to Israel to hear Jesus. They'd never heard the man, Christ Jesus. See, Jesus he's still teaching. And he's still teaching people about God. 1 John 5:20 tells you that. He's acquainting us. He's come to acquaint us with God himself. Jesus is still teaching. And men do not have the option of rejecting what he says. It's really got to be brought home. We need preachers in this world, particularly our country, that make this crystal clear. You do not have the option of rejecting Christ. You do not. You'll be damned if you do. That's how serious it is. God will not smile at you if you ignore Jesus. He will not do it. He's serious about this. And when it says, preach the gospel, the good news, if it's not viewed as good news, well, I prefer not even to think about it. So whether or not we receive Christ, to as many as received him, To them gave he power to become the sons of God. That's John 1:12. To as many as received him, to them gave he power to become the sons of God, not to anybody else. Jesus said, my sheep hear my voice and they follow me. That's what he said. That's what he said. My sheep hear my voice. This is John 10:27. My sheep hear my voice and they follow me. All right, whoever doesn't listen to him and isn't following him, is they're not his sheep. They're not Christians. They're not believers. That's the acid test. Jesus is going to deal with this in our text. It appears that this is not as well known as it should be. Now for our text, John 5, verse 37 through 40. This is a rather lengthy discourse stretching from verse 19 of this chapter, in which he's rebuking those that thought he'd done the wrong thing in healing a man on the Sabbath day and saying that God was his father. So he's still in the middle of this discourse. John 5:37. The Father himself, which has sent me, hath borne witness of me. Ye have neither heard his voice at any time nor seen his shape. And ye have not his word abiding in you, for whom he has sent, him ye believe not. Search the scriptures, for in them ye think ye have eternal life, and they are they which testify of me, and you will not come to me that you might have life. Doesn't that sound serious to you? This is Jesus that knows all things. He thought, see, some we don't know people, so we sometimes have to say I don't know the whole case. But Jesus did. And he said, God's word's not in you. His word's not abiding in you, and you won't come to me. That's pretty strong words. So maybe when you deal with people like this, maybe you think, well, if I got to be patient and teach them a little more. See, that's how men reason. That's not how Jesus reasoned. That's not how he reasoned. Some people got one chance. That's it. That's all he got. Mm-hmm. He went one time to Samaria, and he only stayed 2 days. His entire ministry, 2 days out of his entire ministry, he spent in Samaria. And the people who took it serious went away blessed. Mm-hmm. Everybody else didn't, of course. Now, Jesus is teaching us how to think here. The way men think is determined by the testimony they receive. Whichever testimony from somebody else that they receive determines how they think and how they view the scriptures, how they view life, and so forth. These people didn't think like that. Jesus speaking to here. These people didn't think like Nicodemus thought. Nicodemus said, no man could do the works you do except God was with him. See, these people didn't think that way. They saw a work God, Jesus did that nobody else could do. Huh? He healed an impotent man who'd been impotent for 38 years. He raised him up. Nobody else had ever seen anything like that. And they didn't think like Nicodemus. Nicodemus said, oh, God's got to be with this man. He couldn't do that. They thought through human tradition. They filtered their thoughts through human tradition, which is what sectarianism does. Sectarianism provides you a template through which you sift everything you hear about the Bible. I mean, I was caught in this snare. I know what I'm talking about here. I was caught in a snare myself, that whatever I heard about God or Christ or the Bible, I sifted through the official dogma of the group. And sometimes it was like a bottleneck. You thought, this can't be right. Maybe I just didn't understand what they were saying, you know. You hit these bottlenecks. So if you've experienced this, you know what I'm talking about here. Now, Jesus, he looked at this crowd, and he said, you have not his word abiding in you. His is God. He just got through saying, God gave witness to me. So his, that's God. You do not have God's word abiding in you. That's what he told them. When you think, it's not with what God said in mind. See, if you must arrive at the point, you don't start out this way, but you must arrive at the point where when you think about the things of God, you sift it through, thus saith the Lord. Of course, if you don't have any knowledge of what God said, then that's what you got to pay. You got to boost up your knowledge so you know, so you can sift it through there. Yes. Yes, Sister Julie.
I was just going to comment that I remember when we met Brother Ricky in Florida. He was saying all these things, and I'm like, where are you getting this? Yeah. This is not what I was taught.
Yeah.
You know, but I wanted to know the truth.
Yeah.
And the Lord sent him there so I would hear the truth. And he was backing it all up with scripture, thus saith the Lord. And I was like, well, I guess I was wrong.
Yeah.
You know, what I heard was, I mean, I remember hearing all kinds of stuff, and I remember sitting and thinking, what you're saying is you're contradicting yourself. But when I heard the truth laid out clearly with scripture, it all fit together and made it came alive, it made sense. And so I had to throw that other stuff away.
Yeah.
I'm having presently a number of dialogues with different people and have trouble understanding the scripture. But the trouble they have every single time, the trouble they have is with what other people have said about the Bible, not what the Bible said.
Yep, amen.
Not what scripture said. That's not what given the trouble.
Amen.
What men have said.
Yes.
I won't even introduce the questions. Some of the questions, you know, with the role of women and all this. And the thing that, what do we, divorce and remarriage. And so there's some hot buttons when you press them. But every time people deal with them, they bring up what men have said scripture means. They don't bring up what scripture says.
Yes.
And if they do quote scripture, they add what they think it means. All right, that's, those kind of people do not have the word of God abiding in them. That's what Jesus talked. That's why Jesus is explaining why these people thought the way they did. He was really the Son of God. He really did raise a man up that had been impotent for 38 years. He really did say that God was his Father. These were all the absolute and unvarnished truth. But they didn't have God's word abiding in them. So when they heard this, they compared it with their system. And it did. It didn't fit in there at all.
Amen.
He who have not his word abiding in you. Some versions read this way. You kept it in the word in your heart. It doesn't stay in you. His word is not living in you. As I mentioned, this word is the word of God the Father, who Jesus affirmed in Verse 37, hath borne witness of me. The Father, God the Father, bore witness of Christ. But what God said about Christ went in this ear and out that one. They didn't keep. They didn't keep his word. See, there's a lot of people today, the trouble, the difficulty they have understanding the scripture is they haven't kept what God said. Instead, they have pushed it out and kept what man said.
Amen.
See, you can't defend any sectarian position unless you cling to what man said. impossible. Truth will not support a sectarian position. Jesus will not buttress a sectarian position or division. He will not. So, but see, all these theological systems, denominations, scriptures call them heresies. They're divisions that are based on what's taught. All of them are the result of thrusting the Word of God out and bringing the Word of man in. That's the result. And he's confronting them with this. Jesus has come right out and telling them this. In other words, every person has to come to the point where they live by every word of God. That's Luke 4:4. Man shall live by every word of God. So if God said it, hide it in your heart. Yes. If man said it, put it on a shelf and test it. That's the way it works. There's a propensity in man, as I said, to think in terms of valued human expressions. A young man once came and lived in our vicinity and joined us from college. He said, Brother Given, do you believe in predestination? I said, absolutely not. He said, well, you preach that. I don't believe in predestination. I believe in God. Other people said, do you believe in baptism? I said, no, absolutely not. No. I believe in God that commanded it. See? Now, some people can't receive this kind of stuff, but this is when the Word of God abides in you, your beliefs are based on what's said, not what was interpreted that the Scripture meant. But this is a very thorny problem that if you're serious about witnessing to other people, you will confront this. You'll confront someone that's very strong opinion that runs counter, as you perceive, to the Word of God, but the reason they have it is because they have adopted what somebody else said. Jesus just said it more plainly. You have not His Word abiding in you. See? He just dropped off all the explanations. We're warned about things like the wisdom of the world. God said it's foolishness. Yeah? It's 1 Corinthians 3:19. We're warned about the wisdom of men, 1 Corinthians 2:5. We're warned about philosophy. Philosophy is like a blind hog rooting for a gay acorn. Just stabbing in the dark, trying to come across something. Philosophy, warned about it. And we're warned about the tradition of man, Colossians 2:8. These are all things that men employ as a template on top of the Scripture. They read the Scripture. I did this myself, so I know this is the case. But I come in great difficulty with, I found the Scripture saying stuff that I couldn't, that didn't fit in the template, and I found myself unwilling to just discard that and say, oh, well, maybe it's too hard to understand. It just run head on to what I believed. And thank God that He works with the person who wants to know the truth. Now, Jesus referred to Himself as the one God has sent. Ordinarily, men boast in what they've done. Whether they're politicians or famous church people, they'll tell you what they've done. I've done this, I've done that. I've had a lot of success doing this. But what does Jesus say? He speaks about the one who sent Him. See how different it is, the one who sent me. Men hold before us what they've achieved. Jesus held before us who sent Him. It's a big difference. That's just a big difference here. Yes. See, does God still send people? Yeah. How shall they preach except they be sent? Yes. God still sends people. who are Paul and Apollos? He said, but ministers whom God hath given to every man. So God, yes. God says it's whether or not people hear whom he sends. The one God, that's what qualifies. What qualifies a person, it's a twofold thing that qualifies a person. One, who sent them, and the particular gift or enablement they have qualifies them for the work. That's their qualification. Where did God put them in the body? How did he undo them? To every man is given a measure of faith. That does not, as the charismatics falsely allege, mean that everybody in the world has faith. That is like an expression of idiocy. Yes, every man in Christ has been given a measure of faith, which he later, Romans 12, 1 through 6, which he later calls, that's what how he refers to spiritual gifts are called in 1 Corinthians 12. And they're called gifts in Ephesians 4. Every man has a measure, that is the kind of faith that does something specific. Whatever that measure is, whether it's a prophet, an exhorter, helper, whatever, that's what qualifies him to do the work. That's our view of God sent that person and do him. This means, of course, that Jesus came into the world to do the will of God, carry out his purpose. He said, I can of my own self do nothing. This is John 5:30. I can of my own self. This is Jesus Christ talking here. I can of my own self do nothing. As I hear, I judge, and my judgment is just because I seek not mine own will, but the will of him that sent me. This is how you've got to evaluate your judgment. Why did you make that judgment? See, this is between you and God. I got my own to deal with. But you've got to arrive at why did I make this judgment? Did I make this judgment because this conflicted with the way I was taught? Or do I have this insight into what God has said on this subject? Is that, see now this, this will change why you preach or teach or whatever you do. This will change why you do it. You don't give attention to what men think. This isn't it at all. Jesus said, I didn't come to do my own will. And there were people trying to get him to do what they wanted. Remember that young man that came to him and said, speak to my brother about the inheritance. We've got some iniquity in the home, and could you come and help our family, you know, settle this matter? He said, No. Who made me a divider over you? You can't settle family squabbles. Please don't put your hand in the work of the Lord. I come to do my Father's will. Before he came into the world, he says, lo, I come to do thy will, O God. That's what he came to do, God's will. That's how compelling God's will is. This is the Word that was with God and was God. In the beginning, the Word was with God and was God. For him to come to earth, he had to agree not to do his own will. Just the Father's will. If judgment was executed on Israel because they did not hearken to the prophets and to Moses, what's going to happen if people don't hear Jesus? What do you suppose is going to be God's response to that? Moses testified of the coming Messiah, the only prophecy really he gave of the Messiah. It shall come to pass that whosoever will not hearken unto my words, which he shall speak in my name as a prophet, God is going to send him, which was Jesus. I will require it of him, as Deuteronomy 18:19. Now, Peter stood on the day of Pentecost, and God gave him inspiration. He referred to that text, and here's what he said. It shall come to pass that every soul which shall not hear that prophet shall be destroyed from among the people. That's Acts 3:23. That is how serious God is about people's response to Christ.
Amen.
Destruction. That's the alternative. Jesus goes back to them. He says, whom he has sent, him ye believe not. Jesus is determined. He's the one God sent. And as you know, much is made of God sending Christ. Jesus didn't come into the world because of his high regard for you. I'm not questioning that that's not possible. I'm just saying that's not an incentive enough for the Word to become flesh and dwell among us. That's not his deep personal desire for the Jews that they be saved. That wasn't enough for to get the Word done. He had to come down and do the Father's will. So he came down to do, as he said in John 6:40, the will of him that sent me. It was a prepared agenda, a purpose that was set in place before he ever came. Jesus said of himself, whom the Father has sanctified and sent into the world. So he set him apart and sent him. After Jesus was raised from the dead and returned to heaven, he was in heaven, Peter told the people, unto you first, having raised up his son Jesus, he sent him to bless you and turning away every one of you from your iniquities. So you can tell people this, that God wants to bless you. He really wants to bless you. What does that mean? I have a good job? That means he'll turn you away from your iniquities. That's what that means. See, that'll cut down on a lot of fake interest. Send him to bless you. Not with prosperity, to bless you by turning you away from your iniquities. Why is that a blessing? Because if you aren't turned away from them, you will go to hell just as straight as you can go. That's why that's a blessing. If it wasn't for Jesus, that's just where we'd all go. That's just it.
Yes.
But he came to avert that. He sent him to bless us. The grand objective is also stated in 1 John 4:10, why God sent him. That we might live through him. That is, live with a lively connection with God. What we call reciprocity. See, to survive, you've got to be able to survive being in God's presence, like a fish survives by being in water. Like a worm survives under the surface. See? You've got to be able to survive in God's presence, because eventually everybody is going to face God without any kind of filter. It's going to be face to face. So what Jesus came to do is to get us ready for that inevitable confrontation. You don't want to get sidelined now by things pertaining to this life, and you can. Satan can hijack you and you'll be off on a rabbit trail, all exercised about this or that, that really isn't that important when you get right down to it. I've tried to make, for my personal life, I try not to be involved in anything I can't change. I just stand back, pray about it, it's up to whether of that, but I will not immerse myself in something that I perceive I can't change. Christ's basis for saying the Word of God was not abiding in them. See, he said, the Word of God, his Word is not abiding in you. Now, why did he say that? Because they refused to listen to him. That's why he said that. They didn't listen to give heed to what he said. Now, they admit the truth about Jesus had been announced by John the Baptist, right? He prepared the way for the Lord. The prophets before him gave testimony to it. Jesus himself gave testimony to it. His works, right, gave testimony to it. God himself spoke out of heaven, gave testimony to it. Now, since the day of salvation, there's the witness of the gospel, the record God's given to his son. That bears witness to it. And there's those in whom Jesus is living. They bear witness to it. They're the epistles of Christ. So there you have seven witnesses. Seven witnesses to who Jesus is. You've got the prophets. You've got God the Father, John the Baptist, Jesus himself, the works of Jesus, the gospel of Christ, to those in whom he dwells. You got seven witnesses that Jesus is precisely who he says he is. So you can be completely intolerant of anybody and everybody that rejects Christ. Jesus told his disciples when he sent them out to preach, he said, if they don't receive you, move on. So he told them. Send out the 70. If they don't receive you, shake the dust off your feet, move on. People in Antioch, up Pisidia, didn't receive Paul. Barnabas shook off their, Paul and Silas shook off their feet and moved on. Paul and Barnabas, see? This is how men in the scripture, this is how they conducted themselves. Someplace they didn't stay because there just wasn't enough people. At Athens, there's just a handful of people. They moved on. That doesn't mean they weren't going to hear again. God has a vast array of. But nobody should waste their time when it comes to serving God. If people reject witness after witness after witness after witness, move on. Maybe God will send them someplace else, someone else. Him ye believe not. This is Jesus talking. This is giving you a clue as how Jesus feels about, that's kind of a weak word, but how he feels about those who reject him. Him ye believe not. Now, what are some things Jesus said that we should believe? Well, I took a smattering of things here, just a few. Well, man is impotent without him. Without me, you can do nothing, see? The only means of direction, reality, and reciprocity are him. I'm the way, the truth, and the life. The only effective way to God, no man cometh to the Father but by me. The only source of true illumination, I'm the light of the world. The only means of spiritual sustenance, I'm the bread of life. The only true leader and feeder, I'm the good shepherd. The only means of recovering and being sensitive to God, I'm the resurrection and the life. The only means of bearing fruit, I'm the true vine. There's a lot of other things, but that's... He told people what he was, why he came, what he could do, what God intended for him to do. He didn't hide it. See, these things were not done in a corner. They should not be hidden from people. These things should be told to people. No person in the United States of America should ever be going to a church where they never hear these things. It's inexcusable. It is just inexcusable. This is what people need to hear. And then they need to be told, you've got only got to hear it, you've got to receive it, and you've got to shape your life around what Jesus said. And if it means you got to change things, then you just have to change them. These are not just literary statements. The Bible is not just literature. They're not statements made so people could form a creed, crystallize it, so they could carry it around conveniently, see. They're not revealed to men so they can develop a theological position or be noted for being biblically correct. That's not why these things are given. These all have to do with divine acceptance and approval. Not human approval, divine approval. They relate to being able to safely pass through this present world, arrive at the end of the world and the day of judgment, safe and sound. Jesus is not the means of you realizing your fleshly ambition or to help you realize your dreams. That's become fashionable. fulfill your dreams. That's not what he came to do. Jesus said of some people, "My word hath no place in you." Oh, boy. It jars my soul. Yes. My word has no place. Your heart's so cluttered up, there's no place left for me. When the word of God is within a person, 1 John 2:13 says, it effectually or effectively works in you that believe. Okay? The word of God ever gets in you and resides in you, it works. Mm-hmm. Productivity. Work is not just like activity, it's productivity. So if whatever word gets in you, it'll effectively work. This also applies to the word of Christ. Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly in all wisdom. How's that? Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly in all wisdom. Is it pretty easy to stymie you? You get confused easily? Can't figure things out? Well, we've all been there. But you don't have to stay there. Amen. The word of Christ can dwell in you richly in all wisdom, so you're not confused by a lot of things anymore. You're able to kind of see through what God intends for you to see through, to see past what God intends for you to see past. But the word has to dwell in you richly. Remember, in all in this text, Jesus is indicting these people because his word wasn't abiding in them. God's word wasn't in them, and his word wasn't in them. Didn't stay with them. See, some people, they're content to go someplace on Sunday morning because they kind of feel they should go someplace. If they hear anything from God's word, it's forgotten quickly as they resume the activities they really want to do. And the word of God doesn't stay in them, which means the word of God doesn't do anything. See, the word of God only works effectually when it's in you, when it abides in you. If it doesn't, you're just on your own. That's all. Now then he says to them, "Search the scriptures, for in them you think ye have eternal life. They are they which testify of me." Now he doesn't tell them, now examine your traditions. Examine your traditions now. And if you got some people that are being drawn to Egyptian gods, now get an Egyptian manual and read up on the Egyptian gods and see what you think about them. Like some United States Christians did when the Muslims struck us, they read up. They read up on the Quran. I marvel at who I heard say that they should do this. Become acquainted. Well, Paul didn't check into what the philosophies at Athens, did he? He didn't examine them. See, if you're going to examine something, examine the truth of God. Search the scriptures, not what men have said that are against the scriptures. So if you hear someone that's an atheist, don't read up on what atheists believe and why they believe it. You might end up one yourself.
I remember this similar account we're discussing tonight years back here in this room, and I believe someone said you wouldn't, this might sound kind of crude, you wouldn't study how to work on a Ford if you were a Chevrolet mechanic.
Yeah, that's right.
You would, yeah. You know.
Search the scriptures. Some of the other versions say, so it's not casual. Diligently study the scriptures, make search in the Holy Scriptures, examine the scriptures, pour over the scriptures, so forth. Now there's two different ways of viewing this text, and there is a split of how people view it. The majority of the modern translations read that you are searching the scriptures, but you're searching them with your tradition in mind. That's what we call the indicative mode. The other is the imperative mode, which means search the scriptures, which I think is the right view. And I'll tell you why. It is true that they had been searching the scriptures, but they had not been searching them with Christ in mind. So Jesus is telling them, search them again. With Christ, with me in mind. Search them again with God in mind. You know, that's as I understand it, what he's saying to the people. And I know by personal experience how revolutionary this is when you actually see Christ and God in Scripture and you say, whoa, this is the factor I'd missed. Search the Scriptures. There's a certain thread that runs through Scripture. This is like a certain theme is found throughout Scripture. As far as a person is concerned, the prominent person in the Bible is God. He's the prominent person. The prominent worker is Christ. And when you see them in Scripture, see, that's who you want to see in Scripture. You want to see the work of God in Scripture, not the duty of man. Man does have a duty, but the secret to fulfilling the duty is to see God for who he is and Christ for who he is. Jesus was able to do his commission because he knew who sent him. See, the Father sent me. See, that compelled him to live right. If you know what the Scriptures is about, who it's about, whose purpose is being fulfilled, that will be an incentive to you, see, to follow on and know them. In them ye think ye have eternal life, in the Scriptures. I gather the fact that the Scriptures were given to them to be custodians of it, the lively oracles they're referred to. So they had charge of the Word of God, and they gloried in that they had charge of the Word of God. This same thing has been duplicated in Roman Catholicism, who took the Word of God and hid it in secret chambers for like 1,000 years. Kept it from the people. Nobody had a Bible. They gloried in having the text. See? They gloried in having the text. But having the text is not enough. The text has got to get in you. See, that is to dwell in you richly. Spiritual life is not independent of Scripture. Man lives by every word of God, Luke 4:4. But the Scriptures cannot impart life. See, they will maintain life if you believe them, but the Scripture can't impart life. I don't think I actually believed they could, but I reasoned like that was the case. Like if you just had this, just go home and read the Bible, and you'll be all straightened out about it. And so we go to foreign countries, they get everybody a Bible. Sounds really smart. What do you do if they just read Leviticus? What do you teach people? What do you do? They read the Bible, read Leviticus, and start slaughtering animals. What do you tell them? See? It's not so simple as everybody's got to have a Bible. Somebody's got to know what it means. Someone has to open it up to the people. There's still people observing the Sabbath day because they don't understand. There's still people that think that meats have distinctions, that certain meats shouldn't be eaten. There's still people that think this today because they don't understand. See, the Word of Christ hasn't got in them. So the scribes and Pharisees, they delighted in having the text and being able to handle it. And they could probably find about any text you're looking for. They could find it. In them you think you have eternal life. But he said, but they are they that testify of me. I'm the one. Amen. Jesus is the one who confers eternal life. You aren't more alive because you know a lot of the Scripture. You're alive because Jesus, working through the Scripture, has given you life. Amen. They testify of me, bear witness of me, give proof about me. See, nobody has ever told to study nature and you'll just see God, you'll just see God out there. Some people say, I feel so close to God when I'm out there. I feel close to God. Well, I like serenity too. I like it, but I feel close to God when I'm hearing what he said. My mind's being exposed, his words. That's what does it for me. Yes. Yes, Brother Jason, I'm sorry.
I was just going to add, I think you've already said this, but the scriptures he's talking about here is what we call the Old Testament. So you ought to be able to read the Old Testament and come to Christ.
That's right. That's right. The law will convict you of sin, and then you'll see those promises in there. What a Savior. There they was testify of me. Peter said of Jesus, all the prophets from Samuel and those that follow after, as many as have spoken, have likewise foretold of these days. Sure, this unanimous witness, Samuel, he was a prophet, the first person that was an extensive prophet. That was David was lived with him, simultaneous with him. Samuel and all the prophets, to what Brother Jason just said. See, you can't read the prophets without noting that somebody is coming. Amen. Somebody's going to be, God's going to send. It's going to be a God's servant. It's going to do God's will. It's going to make intercession. It's going to be a captain. It's going to lead the people, teach the people. See, remember that some of the Jews there, when they found Jesus, they said, we have found him of whom the prophets. We read in the prophets, someone has come. We found him. Philip and Nathaniel. Remember? We found him. Boy, they were glad they did too. I can remember when I found him. I can remember it. I was a Christian. I'd done all that I knew what to do. But I can remember when I saw that Jesus was the fulfillment of all the good stuff. All those good promises. I finally, when it registered, that's Jesus, that's who he is. Changed the whole perspective. They testify of me. Remember that angel appeared to John, and John was so stricken with this glory of this angel, he fell down at the angel's feet to worship him. And the angel told him to get up, worship God. The testimony of Jesus is Revelation 19:10. The testimony of Jesus is the spirit of prophecy. It's the life. It's like the blood. Scripture's like the body, and the testimony of Jesus, the blood, that gives it life. So they testify of me. They prove the scriptures, not apologetics, not archaeological finds. Huh? It's the scriptures that testify of Christ. Because they say things that cannot be said of any other person. What God has declared about Christ cannot be said of any other person in all history. Nobody fulfilled those, and honest people knew no one else ever fulfilled them. So if you've got this lengthy period of time, prophecies, of over 2,000 years, nobody ever appeared on the scene that they thought was the Messiah, except when John the Baptist came. He was so different, they could... Maybe this is the Messiah. And then John told him, I am not. I am not. See? They testify of me. Then this lament. And I think this was a lament that Jesus gave. He says, you will not come to me. You will not come to me that you might have life. Now, he knows what he's talking about. He's read their hearts of these people. The New King James Version says, you're not willing to come to me. New American Standard Bible says, you are unwilling to come to me. The NIV says, you refuse to come to me. Basic Bible English says, you have no desire to come. Jewish Bible says, you don't want to come to me. That explanation is still true. Why do people not come to Jesus who's able to save them to the uttermost? Now, why wouldn't somebody come to someone like that who's able to save to the uttermost? It's because they're not willing to do so. It's because they don't want to come to Jesus. It's because they refuse to come to Jesus. They're unwilling to come to Jesus. They have no desire to come to Jesus. It's not because Satan's blocked the way. That's not why. It's not because there's too many hypocrites in the church. That's not why. It's because they can really see no advantage in coming to Jesus. They don't see anything that Jesus offers that they want, and they don't want to come to him. The day that changes, the day a person wants to come to Christ, the way is cleared for him to come. Doesn't make any difference who it is or how long, name it for Saul of Tarsus. It's cleared to come. So see, now you know why people don't come to Jesus. They don't want to. You've got to decide how you're going to handle that, but it gave me personally a lot of relief. Yes, Brother Jason.
The Old Testament said that when the Messiah came, he would be a stumbling block.
That's right.
And a stumbling block is something that offends. So Jesus was he offended them. There was something about him that offended them.
Yeah.
This is still true today.
Mm-hmm.
People still stumble over Jesus. There's something about Jesus that offends them.
Yes.
It doesn't mean everything about Jesus offends them. But there's something about him that offends them. He is a stumbling stone and a rock of offense.
Yeah.
To some people.
Yeah,
when Jesus said, for which of my works do you stone me? Well, they admitted that they couldn't find any fault in what he did, actually. But this stumbling block, he's been appointed. He's either a stepping stone or a stumbling block. He's one or the other. And the rest of you have it, Brother Jonathan?
Yeah, the rejection of Christ, it's more serious than people realize, because it's not like a it's something that you can look at as like a repetitive thing that you can just like afford to keep doing. There'll still be an open door for you, because we have these scriptures saying that God's blinded their eyes and hardened their hearts because of that rejection.
Yeah.
Because it stands to show that if you reject Christ, then God will let you have him. So yeah, it can never be treated lightly when someone rejects, because that's the direction they're heading in.
Do you see, does everybody here see that when people try and make it easier to come to Christ, they've actually compounded the problem? They made it more difficult for the people. Better to just be straight up and say what the Lord requires, because when a person sees that, then God will give a person grace, see, to meet that requirement. That's a good part of this. That is, what's held out to you can't be done just by human willpower and initiative. But when you determine to come to Christ, then heaven kicks into action and clears the way for you to come. That's the good news. Yes, Brother Tony.
And you, that point you were making about the Word of God effectively does a work in us, and and let it dwell in you, as opposed to thrusting it from you. And you wonder, people listen, they hear the Word of God, they hear the gospel, it doesn't do anything. I think what they're doing, they're thrusting it from them. And it's just like I think you said, it's something that they desire more. I don't think they consciously thrust it from them, but what they desire more pushes the Word of God out of them. It's got to be in there. It's got to stay to do a work. Whether that's after you're in the kingdom or before you come in.
That's right. Mm-hmm. Yeah,
I'm sure that the people Jesus talked to didn't think his assessment was proper. But it was, and if any of them did come to see the truth, they could look back and say, hey, that's what the problem was. Yes, Brother Jonathan?
The rejection of Christ, that's something that shouldn't be overlooked, but a reception of Jesus shouldn't be overlooked either.
That's right.
That should take note to encourage that and to help that, rather than that. Like, that's not something to be, in fact, you should be more serious about that.
That's right.
Yeah.
Well, you remember...
When you see it, yeah.
You remember how Paul said to Silas, let's go revisit the churches where we were, and let's see how they're doing. Remember that? See how they're doing. And they check and they strengthened them. And one time there in Acts 9, when Barnabas, I believe, had been comforting the saints, said that the churches had rest then. They'd been persecuted. They were strengthened, they had rest. And walked in the comfort of the Holy Spirit, and they were multiplied, see? So that, when you see these things that we were talking about tonight, you'll have rest. It takes the tediousness out. See, there are some people that they don't see this, and I feel for them, labor for their souls. They don't see this, and so their religion means the outward expression. It's a legitimate word. It's tedious. It's too difficult. It wears them out. See? But when you have a word dwelling in you, it rejuvenates you. Yeah, Brother Gene? Oh, I thought you had something to say.
Well, I do. I was just getting ready. I wouldn't be surprised if this was some of the experience of Saul of Tarsus.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, the goads.
And yeah, the goad, he was kicking against the goad, he couldn't see, until the Lord appeared to him on the road, he couldn't see that there could be anything else. Yeah. And yet I think he had a sense that there was.
Yes, amen. It's important for you to see this and connect it with your own experience. When the day dawned, in your heart, the day dawned, you kind of, you saw what it was all about. It just changed everything. You were transferred from a griper to a thanksgiver, thanksgiving person. Yeah. Yes, Brother Judah.
This fact that you brought up at the very beginning, that what a man thinks of Jesus identifies who he is. I thought of Jesus himself said something about what he came. I came not to bring peace, but a sword.
Yeah.
It was to reveal that this is what Simeon said in the temple, that the thoughts of many hearts shall be revealed.
Revealed, yeah.
So, and at least in that instance, that's what Jesus was saying: is I came to reveal who is with God and who is not.
That's right.
People like to be around those who have common interests. So, if I find someone who likes the same type of things that I do, I enjoy talking with them because we have common interests. We're like one another, at least on some level. And this is what provision has been made for us to be like Christ. And when we take advantage of that provision, we want to be with Christ.
Yeah.
And we're continually made more like Christ.
Yes.
So then what we think of Christ is also what God thinks of Christ, and we'll be accepted because of that. And all of that is Jesus' work.
That's right.
That's not something that we originate even.
No.
It comes from Jesus.
All right, Sister Barb.